issue, pertaining to that area, pertaining to that mental setup of people with this type of tools. If you want to say, I want to travel, then that is idea. When do you want to travel? If it is winter, Napoleon's army that went to Siberia at the time of winter. So we want to see also the environmental conditions. When you are going to have that travel, and with which vehicle you are going to travel, for what purpose you are going to travel, on the basis only we can say when you can exactly reach and how much your voyage or travel can be benefited. So it is ideology, is a systemic study of what you want, supportive factors, circumstantial factors, disruptive factors, and tools or promoters of supportive factors and supporters in the society for the disruptive factors. All of these 7 units are totally studied in ideology. And ideology emerges in sociology. Human beings, they grouped to form society. Collective society, integral society, federal society. Collective society in the form of clans, castes and everything, etc. They made integral society in the form of nations and provinces. And various other expanded global network. Now we are having universal brotherhood and universal fraternity, and we are having a global village system. It is known as a federal type of these things. When society emerges, then immediately necessity boosts. The first emergence ideology is known as social ideology. When society emerges, lot of people, lot of needs. So they have to implant lot of methodologies, technicalities and tools for giving out the possibilities of exploration and scrutiny of the resources. I want to live. I want to have a better life. I want to have a comparatively better life. Better life is of two types. My life better than him is personal comparative. My life better than what it was yesterday is temporal comparative. So this betterment is straight going on in the pursuit of human being. So a lot of resources are exploited, explored, experimented and extravagated. All of these things result in economy. First to society, society results in economical development. Whenever there is a resource, then the mind becomes the culprit. When a person is free from an opportunity or free from a circumstantial urge to commit a blunder, error, mistake, sin, offense, crime or error, at the time the person is totally free. He is a non-opportunistic criminal or innocent. Non-opportunistic in psychology or criminology we used to say, they are non-opportunistic criminals or non-opportunistic innocents. So the innocence has not been well exploited by the circumstances to boost the person to go into an offense. At that time only there are 2 systems which evolved. One is the moral evolution, second is the spiritual evolution. First human being evolved, that is biological evolution. Then they grouped together, that is social evolution. When they grouped, they explored the richness and resources of the society for their utility, development and sustenance. Then it resulted in economical development. When economy results in resources, time sharing, power sharing, you are here, taratamya. Great and less, good or bad, you or me. So the ego clashes. That is also an unavoidable growth or unavoidable factor or component in the era of civilization, which has resulted in 2 major systems for control. One is a political system which established the morality in the society by means of justice. And second is a spiritual system which provoked the inner conscience to make the person rule themselves, control themselves, by means of which divine justice is established. So this is ideology. So now we are going to deal with 4 systems, all the 4 systems. What is the sociological evolution of India? And what is the economical evolution of India? And what is the political system which governs the morale? And as well as the instinctive conscience which is governed by the spiritual renaissance or revolution made by the greatest seers, saints and implanters of the society, morale and spiritual realization. So this is known as ideology. The second thing is, no doubt it is a research oriented topic and it cannot be sweetened by interesting stories, analogies and diversions. This is a serious thought and we are inside a problem. And we are inside a problem for our future, in which our generations may suffer, our great country may suffer. So it is a subject of seriousness, it is a subject of severity, it is a subject of sturdity and stolidity. So we have to see that how far we can go for a proper way of venture, by which we can pray for it, we can perform for it, we can work for it, we can plan for it, we can execute with collective minds. The second thing is necessity. There are 4 necessities in the society. Necessity arises when there are 4 situations. Number one, whenever there is a deterioration for the essential energy. Second thing, whenever there is a counter appropriation of the other side energy. Paritranaya sadhuna vinashaya chadurkrita. So like that, the first thing says that the deterioration of the essentialities of the society. The second thing, over appropriation, or it is misappropriation or counter appropriation of the other side. The third thing is a tumultuousness in the society, a great calamitous situation in the society. Fourth thing is inertia, nothing is moving. So whenever good thing is reduced or bad thing is more in proportion, or the society creates a very chaotic base, or the society is neither having good or bad, it is lifeless and it is inert, then we have to rise our spiritual energies. Now we are having counter appropriation and we are slowly reaching tumultuousness. This is not the stage of necessity for our country according to this scientific, computer, technical, nano era, whatever they call in science. So this is the necessity. Third thing is leadership. Each and everybody, they have a servant inside and they have a leader inside. So a leader has a perfect servant quality and a servant must have a leadership quality to instigate his followers. So each and everybody must have a component which has to rule themselves and to be subservient to their predecessors and also to teach and create subservience to their successors. So this must be a simultaneously existing bilateral and bivalent component in each and every leader. So leaders, they have the hierarchy into five major member groups. One is the leader, second is the team, third is the commander, and fourth is the soldier, fifth is the subject. So it must start with a leader who is the unifying spirit. Who is the leader? Leader is different from a carrier. Any person without having the mind, the potence, the compassion, the radiation to pronounce such a verdict by which you are united, by the qualities of oratory, by the qualities of sacrifice, by the quality of brotherhood, by the quality of affecting, affectionate, radiative splendor by which he is altruistic and all-encompassing, cosmopolitan in nature, that is known as leadership. And any person with his fame in media, any person with his just literary and oratory skills, any person by show and projection and image construction technology in the society, those people, they are not leaders. They are carriers of the society as per their norms. They are carrying the society, they are miscarrying the society, they are alluring the society so that they can use the society as a tool to benefit themselves. So, carrier is a person who takes the benefit of the society for his growth, whereas leader is a person who sacrifices himself, who uses himself as a tool for the growth of the society. So, leadership is the first thing. Second thing, a leader cannot immediately execute something. He needs a proper team. So, a leader is more blessed and fortunate only if he has a team. If there is only one person in a drama or in a company where the other person, all other persons are Paramananda, Sishyalu or Kauravas, then how can he run the company or run the show? They will be either foolish or they will be totally against you. So having a supportive atmosphere, the team is also a blessing. Third thing, commanders, those who are going to propagate. All people, they establish only like that. Germany, if you see Hitler, if you see Mussolini, if you see Karl Marx, if you see political systems, religious systems, like ISKCON even, everybody, they spread only by a leader. Chaitanya was a leader and there was a team for Chaitanya, and now propagator or the promulgator or the commander was ISKCON Prabhupada. Now you see Prabhupada is a leader now for the contemporary ISKCON society, and there are lot of people in the team work, there is a committee. Now there are commanders, now there are soldiers selling the books, giving interpretations by various means. Commercial approach, literary approach, knowledge approach, service approach, then personal counseling approach, innumerable psychological, intellectual, social connectivities are there. They are now there. Then subjects are the sheep, the flock of sheep, the society, who bothers about anything, or who bothers about something which is not to be bothered, or who does not bother about something which is to be bothered, or who bothers about everything. So these are all the members of the society, and they must be bleached with, they are being bleached with brainwashing element. So we want them to be bleached by blind faith and blind pathway. They are being brainwashed by the people. We want a blind faith in brain energizing systems, not in brainwashing systems. The same blind faith and blind practice must be incorporated in a system which is brain energizing system, not washing system. So everybody, they have this panchayudha or panchavayava, which is known as a leader, a team, and a commander, and soldiers, committed soldiers and subjects. This is how you have to create India's mission, not by speeches, oratory, publication of pamphlets, everything, etc. These are all the parts of these things. Then what are all the maximum participation possible? One thing is instigating, you can provoke others. Nourish, if somebody is already provoking, you can just nourish them by means of your physical, mental, financial supports. And the third thing is supportive. You can totally participate and render your life. Fourth benefit is, fourth participation is very simple. It is non-maleficence. If you don't disturb them, they will flourish at all. The fourth thing is advesha. Advesha, we used to say in Shastras also, what to do to attain God. The first requisite is advesha. You need not have any priti. If you are having non-maleficence, that itself is a very great reward. That is an ornament for attaining God. Likewise, we must not be, at least even though if we are not ready to be beneficial, we must be